The Lord be with you.
And
good morning. It's wonderful to see you all. This is a very special day, a long day, but a very special day. We made it all the way back from, where'd we go? Panama Canal. And I came down to the church yesterday, and going back home, I fell in the laundry room. So that's just to warn you that I may, depending on how I feel, we may be calling upon the elders to do all, you know, I will institute the Holy Communion and all of that, but I may not actually be taking part in the distribution of that. It sort of depends on, okay, Joshua, you take over. It sort of depends. So we'll take a look at that. I'll make that another announcement. This at the close of service. So we ask that everyone complete the record of fellowship that you find in the pew. If you are visiting with us, we would also appreciate your address for our records, and especially your email or your phone number or whatever, so that we can get a hold of you. And then if you have any prayer requests, those can be indicated on that form as well. They will be collected by the elders later in the service. So let's speak our mission statement together, and then we will go forward with our opening hymn. And you will stand for the last verse of the opening hymn. Grace exists to strengthen people in their relationship with Jesus Christ and to empower them to share Jesus with others. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit.
Amen.
Our help is in the name of the Lord. If you, O Lord, kept a record of sins, O Lord, who could stand?
But if you, there is forgiveness.
Since we are gathered to hear God's word and call upon him in prayer and praise, and receive the body and blood of our Lord Jesus Christ in the fellowship of this altar, let us first consider our unworthiness before God and one another, that we have sinned in thought, word, and deed, and that we cannot free ourselves from our sinful condition. Together as his people, let us take refuge in the infinite mercy of God, our Heavenly Father, seeking his grace for the sake of Christ and saying, God, be merciful to me, a sinner. Almighty God, have mercy upon us. Forgive us our sins and lead us to everlasting life. Amen. Almighty God, in his mercy, has given his Son to die for us, and for his sake forgives us all our sins. As a called and ordained servant of Christ, and by his authority, I therefore forgive us all our sins in the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit.
Amen.
You may be seated. We stand. The Lord be with you.
And also with you.
Let us pray. O God, in the glorious transfiguration of your beloved Son, you confirmed the mysteries of faith by the testimonies of Moses and Elijah. In the voice that came from the bright cloud, you wonderfully foreshadowed our adoption by grace, mercifully making us co-heirs with the King in his glory, and bring us to the fullness of our inheritance in heaven through the same Jesus Christ our Lord, who lives and reigns with you and the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever. You may be seated. The Old Testament reading for the Transfiguration of our Lord is from the 24th chapter of the book of Exodus. And Moses took the blood and threw it on the people and said, "Behold the blood of the covenant that the Lord has made with you in accordance with these, with all these words." Then Moses and Aaron, Nadab and Abihu, and 70 of the elders of Israel went up. And when they saw the God of Israel, there was under his feet, as it were, a pavement of sapphire stone, like the very heaven for clearness. He did not lay his hand on the chief men of the people of Israel. They beheld God and ate and drank. The Lord said to Moses, "Come up to me on the mountain and wait here, then that I may give you the tablets of stone with the law and the commandment which I have written for their instruction." So Moses rose with his assistant Joshua, and Moses went up to the mountain of God. And he said to the elders, "Wait here for us until we return to you. And behold, Aaron and Hur are with you. Whoever has a dispute, let him go to them." Then Moses went up on the mountain, and the cloud covered the mountain. The glory of the Lord dwelt on Mount Sinai, and the cloud covered it 6 days. And on the seventh day he called Moses out of the midst of the cloud. Now the appearance of the glory of the Lord was like a devouring fire on top of the mountain in the sight of the people of Israel. Moses entered the cloud and went up on the mountain. And Moses was on the mountain 40 days and 40 nights. This is the word of the Lord. We speak responsively, Psalm 2. As for me, I have set my king on Zion, my holy hill.
I will tell
the Lord said to me, "Ask of me, and I will make the nations your heritage,
and the ends of the earth your possession.
You shall break them with a rod of iron,
and dash them into pieces like a potter's vessel.
Now, therefore, O kings, be wise.
Be warned, O rulers of the earth.
Serve the Lord with fear, and rejoice with trembling. And you perish in the way, for his wrath is quickly kindled. The epistle reading is from the first chapter of 2 Peter. For we did not follow cleverly devised myths when we made known to you the power and coming of our Lord Jesus Christ, but we were eyewitnesses of his majesty. For when he received honor and glory from God the Father, and the voice was borne to him by the majestic glory, "This is my beloved Son, in whom I am well pleased," we ourselves heard this very voice, born from heaven, for we were with him on the holy mountain. And we have the prophetic word made more fully confirmed, to which you will do well to pay attention as to a lamp shining in a dark place until the day dawns and the morning star rises in your hearts. Knowing this, first of all, that no prophecy of Scripture comes from someone's own interpretation, for no prophecy was ever produced by the will of man, but men spoke from God as they were carried along by the Holy Spirit. This is the word of the Lord. Gospel according to St. Matthew, the 17th chapter. After 6 days, Jesus took with him Peter and James and John, his brother, and led them up a high mountain by themselves. And he was transfigured before them, and his face shone like the sun, and his clothes became as white as light. And behold, there appeared to them Moses and Elijah talking with him. And Peter said to Jesus, Lord, it is good that we are here. If you wish, I will make three tents here, one for you, one for Moses, and one for Elijah. He was still speaking when, behold, a bright cloud overshadowed them, and a voice from the cloud said, This is my beloved Son, with whom I am well pleased. Listen to him. And when the disciples heard this, they fell on their faces and were terrified. But Jesus came and touched them, saying, Rise and have no fear. And when they lifted up their eyes, they saw no one but Jesus only. And as they were coming down the mountain, Jesus commanded them, Tell no one the vision until the Son of Man is raised from the dead. This is the gospel of the Lord. We confess our common faith in the words of the Apostles' Creed. I believe in God, the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, and in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, died, and was buried. He descended into hell. The third day he rose again from the dead. He ascended into heaven and is seated at the right hand of God the Father Almighty. From thence he will come to judge the living and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Christian Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen. You may be seated. At this time, we invite the children to come forward for the children's message.
Good morning. Oh, that'd be great. Yeah. Oh, y'all don't want to sit out this way so you can see. Nope. You can't touch it, though. So I was looking at a recipe because I wanted to make something, and it calls for baking powder. So I was trying to, you know, follow the recipe and put all my ingredients out ahead of time, but I made a boo-boo. And I don't know which one is which. Can you tell which one is baking powder?
That one.
You think it's that one? How many of y'all think it's that one? We got two. Okay. How many think it's this one? Y'all think this one's baking powder? Maybe. I can't tell by smelling it either.
Yeah.
So what I have, this is not water. It looks like water. But here, smell it. Tell me if that smells like water.
What does it smell like?
You want to smell it? That doesn't smell like water, does it?
It smells like sink water.
It's stinky, isn't it?
Stinky.
It's garbage water.
It's not garbage water. It's actually, it's vinegar. Good job. High five, my man. That is vinegar. You want to smell it one more time? You're a brave girl. It does stink. No, I don't want you to inhale vinegar. But if I pour this in the one that we think is baking powder, it's supposed to fizz and stuff. It's supposed to help things rise when you bake with it. So like if I put it in cookies or something, it helps the cookies kind of get fluffy. So let's test it out. Y'all think this one's baking powder, right? Okay, let's test it. Don't move the cart, though, or we'll make a big, big mess. Okay, you ready? Let's see. Uh-oh. What? Look at that.
Uh-oh.
I think it's safe to say that that is baking powder. Well, and look at that. It kind of looks like a cloud, doesn't it?
Let's try this.
That looks like a volcano.
It is kind of cool. Let's see. Oh, don't move the cart.
Yeah, we can make that into a volcano.
Hey, can you take your hands off the cart, please? Thank you. Okay, let's try this one. Let's see. That is very anticlimactic. Nothing happened. So it only works with baking powder, though. That's all I have left. But look, it kind of looks like a cloud, how clouds are nice and fluffy. It won't do anything if I mix both of them. But, so when I follow the recipe, you see it clouds up like that? The gospel message today talked a little bit about a cloud that Jesus was in. So he went up on this mountain with three of his disciples. And while he was up there, he was transformed. How many of y'all like Transformers?
Me.
You do have a toy like that. Nice. And so just like this transformed, it started out as baking powder. And then once I added the vinegar, it turned it into this chemical reaction and it transformed into something else. It did.
Can I try something?
There's no more. It's all empty.
No, I just want to mix
it. We're not going to mix it. It'll get really nasty.
Please.
No.
Please,
no. But, so here's the thing. You know what? They were figuring out a recipe, too, because we like to test things, right? That's why y'all want to mix it together, because we like to test things. Well, the disciples, they had been around Jesus, and, you know, they probably wanted some proof, just like we do sometimes. Like, how many of you look up the weather to see what kind of clothes you got to put on? I bet you all the adults do. How many of y'all check the temperature before you get dressed? Look at that. All of them do. That's how y'all know what to wear every day. But sometimes you still wait, even if you check the weather, you still wait to see what it feels like outside. Well, the disciples, when they were up there, they got proof of who Jesus was, because you know what happened? He was up on that mountain, and all of a sudden his clothes turned super duper white, like really, really bright white, like hurt your eyeballs white.
They didn't melt.
But his clothes turned really, really white, and he got really, really shiny. And then there was this big cloud, and they heard a voice from the cloud that said, "Hey, this is my son, and I love him, and I'm pleased with him."
Did that?
Yeah, so kind of like this looked like a cloud. That's kind of what they saw. And then they knew that they could trust who he was. Because back then, you know, people would say that they were a Messiah.
That looks like coffee.
That does look a little bit like. But, so we know the story about Jesus, right? We know that he died to pay for our sins. We know that he rose again, right, and went to heaven. So whenever you see things bubble or you see clouds, I want you to think about that that's a recipe you can follow. Because we know we can trust Jesus and who he is. And we know that he is the main ingredient for us to be able to get to heaven. So can you fold your hands with me? Then I'm going to let you go back to your seat.
Use the baking soda.
We're going to pray. Can you fold your hands for me? And then repeat after me. God, thank you for giving us a recipe to get us to heaven to be with you. Help us to share this amazing recipe with everyone we meet. In your name we pray. Amen. Amen. Good job. Y'all go back to your seat.
Good morning. Got to ask you, see a show of hands, how many people have problems out there? Only four. What's going on with that? I'm assuming the laughter means everybody. So, some problems are bigger, some are smaller, obviously. But there's a song about taking your problems and turning them over to God. It's called Don't Sweat the Small Stuff.
Everywhere you look, people are letting worry drag them down, keeping them up at night, spinning their lives around. Can't say I've never been there. I speak of what I know. There's plenty of times that I felt like that, and not so long ago. There were times I wasn't sure if I was gonna keep my car, keep my lights on, or keep my house. That's the scariest by far. But when I surrendered all to God, He showed me how His mercies flow. Showed me what His love can do, and that eased my heavy load. So don't sweat the small stuff. To Jesus, it's all small. No matter how big your problem is, He can handle them all. Drop your problems at the cross. Too much is not enough. But cast your cares on Him and don't sweat the small stuff. I'm not saying your life will be easy, but it could be easier. Put your trust in Jesus, He's got your back for sure. He'll provide your strength and comfort, that much is guaranteed. In His perfect timing, He'll provide your every need. So don't sweat the small stuff. To Jesus, it's all small. No matter how big your problem is, He can handle them all. Drop your problems at the cross. Too much is not enough. So cast your cares on Him and don't sweat the small stuff. Don't sweat the small stuff. To Jesus, it's all small. No matter how big your problem is, He can handle them all. Drop your problems at the cross. Too much is not enough. So cast your cares on Him. Don't sweat the small stuff.
Grace, mercy, and peace to you from God our Father and the Lord Jesus Christ in the unity of the Holy Spirit. The text of the sermon this morning is the gospel reading from the book of the Holy Gospel according to St. Matthew, the 17th chapter. Jesus approached, and as He touched them, He said, "Get up, do not be afraid." So far the text. Now most of you realize or know that the lovely Elvira and I spent the last 11 days or so on a cruise of the Panama Canal and associated areas. And probably if you've ever been down there, and even if you haven't, you probably realize that this is not Texas. It is filled with rainforests and jungles. And one of the things that we found, or that was pointed out to us on the cruise and the various excursions we went, the guide was always pointing out chameleons. There are lots of chameleons in the jungle. Lots and lots of them. And they have developed, God has given them this ability to change color. And as they change color for their own protection. Basically, they are normally brown or green or white. And I remember one of the tour guides, one of the excursion guides that we were on had a piece of paper that was brown and yellow and green. And he put a chameleon on this piece of paper. And amazingly, the chameleon started changing color, but he couldn't figure out what to do. And so he was just sort of flashing one color and another color and another color. And amazing. Amazing. He could not find a way to show his true colors. Now, when a human being is asked to show their true colors, it usually means to say what they really are, or to behave as they really are. And we usually mean that in a bad way. Well, he showed his true colors. But Jesus became white on the top of the mountain of Transfiguration. And you could say that he was showing his true colors, but in a good sense. His holiness and his divinity beamed from within him. He didn't conceal his glory, he let it shine. It was a beautiful sight for Peter, James, and John, one that they would never forget. Next slide, please. Jesus took them up to the high mountain to reveal his glory. Now, I love hiking in nature. It cleanses the mind and the stresses of the body. It pushes you to the limit. It gets you away from the business of life and helps you to reset. But this was more than a physical ploy used by Jesus to clear their minds. Moses went up to Mount Sinai into a cloud of fire to receive the Ten Commandments from God. The elders also went up and ate and drank in the presence of God. When Elijah ran from his ministry in fear of Jezebel, he too fled to Mount Horeb, also known as Mount Sinai. And there the Lord spoke to him in a gentle whisper. So Jesus takes Peter and James and John up a mountain, not to reveal his glory, not only to reveal his glory to them, but also for them to see Moses and Elijah, these icons of the faith. Moses, the lawgiver, and Elijah, the prophet, they were not dead. They were alive and well and having a conversation with Jesus. What a glorious, glorious sight that was. In some ways, it was indescribable. Matthew says that Jesus' clothes shone as bright as light, and his face shone like the sun. Luke describes his clothes as lightning. Mark mentions that they were brighter than anyone could bleach them. Different ways of what was describing what was really seemingly indescribable. The glory of God shining through the clothing of a man. Jesus had done glorious things, like calming the storm and walking on water, healing lame people and lepers, and raising the dead. But this was, in another sense, a completely different ballgame. He wasn't just showing his divinity through his actions. He was showing his very being. He was, in his very essence, the glorious God in the flesh. And the disciples got to see it with their very own eyes. Peter and James and John were witnesses to a beautiful view of Jesus. As they describe it to us, the Holy Spirit wants us to envision it with our eyes of faith as well, as if we were standing there with Peter and James and John, staring at Jesus too. But the conversation that Jesus was having with Moses and Elijah was not one that the disciples wanted to hear. They were talking about Jesus' exodus, how Jesus was going to leave and finish out his ministry. When the Israelites left the slavery of Egypt, it had to happen at the death of the firstborn children of Egypt and the firstborn lambs of Israel, of the Israelites. This Exodus, in order to free us from our sin and death, would happen at the death of Jesus. Moses and Elijah understood that very well. They were able to discuss this with Jesus and not try to talk him out of it. They were able to speak on the same level as Jesus and encourage him on the way to heaven. This is what they had prophesied about. They knew what had to be done. Jesus would suffer and die on the cross. This glorious God would have to reveal his glory once again and go down from the mountain to the valley of the shadow of death. Next slide, please. The disciples didn't know what to say. But that never seemed to stop Peter, did it? He wanted to build three shelters, one each for Moses and Elijah and Jesus. He wanted this moment to last forever. And who can blame him? I would too. There were occasional moments of happiness in life that you want to build a shelter around you. You wish that they would last forever. You wish you could build a bubble around your children and never have to send them off to college or away from home. You wish that you could move off to a cabin and shut yourself off from the world. Build your own little shelter, as it were. I wish, as a pastor, I could protect families from hurt and from divorce and from suffering and pain. I wish the devil didn't exist. I wish that sickness and disease were eradicated. I wish there was no drug and alcohol problems in the world. But no matter how much I warn, no matter how much I pray, the sickness, the sin, and the death eventually make it through. There are no shelters big enough to keep people from the elements of the world. They have to understand this reality even as we pray. God said he would walk us through the valley of the shadow of death, and there is no going around it. We like to think that it happens to everyone else until, of course, it happens to us. No matter how many shelters you try to put up, how many exercise programs, how many diets, how many safety locks you put on your doors, your time is coming. We live in the valley of the shadow of death, even when we're up on the mountain. No shelters can protect us from it. It's the reality of life. For the disciples, this moment wasn't supposed to last forever. It was only meant to give them and us a glimpse of who Jesus truly is, so that we would know who was going to the cross. This is God who is going to die for the sins of the world. It wasn't only what they saw, but also what they heard. A voice came out of the cloud saying, "This is my Son, whom I love. With him I am well pleased. Listen to him." It seemed so basic, the words of the Father. The Father is proud of his Son, his only begotten Son, the one and only. Peter said that Jesus received honor and glory from the majestic glory when the Father spoke from heaven. The Father wanted the Son to be revered and respected and heard. It seemed so simple. Listen to him. But it's interesting when you think of what just happened. Jesus had just shone as bright as the sun. He looked glorious. They were enamored with the sight, but the disciples were supposed to listen to him, not stare at him and look at him. That is what Peter said in the epistle reading for today as well. We have also had the completely reliable prophetic word. You do well to pay attention to it, as to a lamp shining in a dark place until the day dawns and the morning star rises in your hearts. Why listen? Remember what Jesus is talking about, his coming departure. It's the one thing they didn't want to listen to. They wanted Jesus to rule powerfully over the world. They wanted his kingdom to come on earth so he could overthrow the governments that were oppressing them. They didn't want Jesus to die, so they weren't getting it. If they had listened, his death wouldn't have come as a surprise, and neither would his resurrection. They would have saved themselves a lot of worry and heartache if they had only listened and believed what it was that they had heard. The word takes us outside of ourselves, you see, and our problems. And it reminds us of the God who rules through it all and in it all to bring people to heaven. He doesn't shelter us from it. He shelters us through it. We need to listen carefully to what he has to say. We love it when God promises us protection. We love it when he says the hairs of our heads are numbered. But we don't like it when he talks about pain and suffering and sacrifice. We'd rather ignore sin rather than confront it, because we don't want the cross. We pray for success. We pray for health. We pray for no cross. We pray for all glory. We love the glorious visions of life. We don't want to listen to the rest. Sometimes we need the Father to confirm us, to confront us with a firm and stern listen to him. We need to drive back into the world, to the word, and just let him speak to us and tell us of his promises to get us through this valley, not around this valley. When the Father speaks, the disciples are overwhelmed. All they can do is fall on their faces. They are in the presence of holiness and majesty, and it is terrifying. Just like it was for Adam and Eve. They have a profound sense of guilt and shame in his presence. No more foolish words or suggestions from Peter, just sheer silence and terror. But this is where God's holiness has put us, on our faces in fear. Then we have no choice but to listen, because our eyes can't look and our mouths have nothing to say. So we go back to the words of the Father. Listen to him. This is the center and focus of everything we hear in the Bible. It has to point us directly to Jesus and what he has to say. Next slide, please. Before Jesus says everything, anything, Jesus approached and he touched them. Isn't that a beautiful thing? Don't overlook this simple gesture, a simple touch. People miss that in our society. They reach out for help to the internet, but it's not the same as talking to someone in person and having them hug you or hold your hand. Teachers are told not to touch their students because of all the abusive touch that has happened. But in the same sense, we are made physical creatures. We need to be touched from time to time. It isn't anything perverted. Jesus doesn't do anything but gently touch them. He doesn't strike them. He doesn't whack them in the head. He gently touches them, saying to them with his hands, "It's okay." So in the Lord's Supper, Jesus touches us. It's nothing profound, a little bit of bread, a little bit of wine. It's so simple and yet so beautiful. He touches us with his body and blood. He touches us. You're forgiven, he says. All is well. And we crave this gentle touch from Jesus. We need it. And then Jesus issues a wonderful command. Get up and do not be afraid. God isn't going to kill you. He's come to kill himself for you on the cross. And that's not all. As they were coming down the mountain, Jesus commanded them, do not tell anyone what you have seen until the Son of Man has been raised from the dead. It's kind of funny that Jesus told Peter, James, and John not to say anything of what had happened until after the resurrection. He didn't want people flocking to him or trying to make him king of the earth. But here is one time at least when Peter kept his big mouth shut. He didn't say anything until after the resurrection. What's the final point? That it will not end in failure. Jesus will rise. That's why we need not fear. Jesus is going to win in the end. Death is going to be conquered. Sin will be paid for. Heaven will be yours, free of charge, through faith, through the season of Lent. Don't forget the end. Jesus will say to you on Judgment Day, don't be afraid. Get up. Come and be with me in heaven, where you will see my true color forever. Next slide, please. The hymn writer says it so well. Precious Lord, take my hand. Lead me on. Let me stand. I am tired. I am weak. I am worn. Through the storm, through the night, lead me on through the light. Lead me on through the light. Take my hand, precious Lord. Lead me home. Amen. And may the peace of God, which passes all understanding, guard and keep our hearts and minds together in Christ Jesus. Amen. Okay, we're going to need three elders up here. We have quite a long list of prayers, and so I'm not going to name all of them in the prayers, but I do want to announce them now. So we're going to pray for Diane Smith's spine surgery tomorrow. We're praying for Diane Stiff and her recovery. We are praying for a friend and niece, pray for her healing. This is Jane. Is this her, Jane? Is this her, your niece, or is this another friend? It's Jane and Gordon Bronstead. Is your neighbor? Okay. And she is praying for, we're praying for her healing, right? And safe travels for the Bronstead's grandson and wife. For the Gilberts have requested prayers for Jalen Cobbs. She's having surgery tomorrow. We are praying for the Edges have requested prayers for Brenton. His right knee is infected, and doctors are trying to save his leg. For cousin Marjorie, this is Jane Clausers, has requested prayers for her cousin Marjorie Winoak, whose husband just went to be with his Lord this past week. We pray for all those who are involved in the Ukrainian war. This prayer request from Ray and Henrietta Adam for Pastor Edge on his installation and for his family. And that's it. So I will be praying for those all en masse. Majestic Lord, transfigure our simple gifts in a way that will inspire all people to proclaim your everlasting message of love. Strip away our biased convictions so that through our selfish giving, we can gaze clearly on your vision for our lives. In the name of your Son, the Beloved One, we pray. Amen. Heavenly Father, you revealed your glory in the transfiguration of your Son, who tabernacled among us in the flesh. Open our eyes that by faith we would see him continuing to tabernacle among us in this divine service. Grant that we would heed your admonition to listen to him as he forgives and preserves us at the font, the pulpit, and the altar. Lord, in your mercy. Holy God, we ask for your blessings on this congregation, especially for our catechumens. We celebrate the baptismal birthdays of Becky Sims, Kelly Smythe, and Azariah Duby, and remember fondly the birthdays of Jessica Dixon, Abigail Vilton, Jace Jones, Levi Parsons, Luke Parsons, Zayden Bray, and Nick Pappas. As Moses was changed when he saw your glory on Mount Sinai, may we who have beheld your glory in the face of Christ also be transformed and given boldness of spirit to share your glory abroad. Lord, in your mercy. Almighty God, Moses and Elijah appeared with the Savior in glory, witnessing all that the law and the prophets speak about him. Grant wisdom to all pastors and church workers to open your scriptures in such a way that everyone would hear the voice of Jesus calling them to life. Lord, in your mercy. Heavenly Father, bless the families of your church, that parents would teach faith to their children, and that the forgiveness of sins would be proclaimed in all households. Remember also all expectant mothers, that they and their babies would be kept safe and healthy throughout their pregnancy. Lord, in your mercy. Almighty Father, you alone establish all authority on earth. Bless those who are entrusted with authority both here and abroad to serve with integrity and honor for the well-being of all. Grant that all division, conflict, and strife would give way to unity, peace, and quietness, Lord, in your mercy. God of all comfort, you alone bring peace that passes understanding to troubled hearts. Remember all those afflicted, as we have mentioned them before, and those that we name in our hearts now. That they would know your presence, taste your peace, and receive healing according to your gracious will, ever trusting in the hope and resurrection, Lord, in your mercy. Lord, we praise you, for we are fearfully and wonderfully made. Give us ears to hear your voice speaking through your word, holy lips to receive Christ's blessed sacrament with repentance and faith, and holy awe at your glory granted to us in the means of grace. Lord, in your mercy. Lord God, our power, your power is beyond compare and your glory beyond understanding. Open our hearts to know you through the glory of your Son, whose saving will and purpose has rescued us from sin, death, and made us your own people by baptism and faith. For you, blessed and eternal Father, belong all honor, glory, worship, and praise with your beloved Son and the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever. The Lord be with you.
And also with you.
Lift up your hearts.
We lift them to the Lord.
Let us give thanks to the Lord our God.
It is right to give him thanks and praise.
It is truly good, right, and salutary that we should at all times and in all places give thanks to you, Holy Father, Almighty and Everlasting God, for the countless blessings you so freely bestow on us and all creation. Above all, we give thanks for your boundless love shown to us when you sent your only begotten Son, Jesus Christ, into our flesh and laid on him our sin, giving him into death that we might not die eternally. Because he is now risen from the dead and lives and reigns to all eternity, all who believe in him will overcome sin and death and will rise again to new life. Therefore, with angels and archangels, and with all the company of heaven, we laud and magnify your glorious name, evermore praising you and saying, blessed are you, O Lord our God, King of all creation, for you have had mercy on us and given your only begotten Son that whoever believes in him should not perish but have eternal life. We give you thanks for the redemption you have prepared for us through Jesus Christ. Grant us your Holy Spirit that we may faithfully eat and drink of the fruits of the cross and receive the blessings of forgiveness, life, and salvation that come to us in his body and blood. Hear us as we pray in his name and as he taught us. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever and ever. Amen. Our Lord Jesus Christ, on the same night in which he was betrayed, took bread. And when he had given thanks, he gave it to his disciples and said, take, eat. This is my body which is given for you. This do in remembrance of me. After, in the same way also he took the cup after supper, and when he had given thanks, he gave it to them, saying, "Drink of it, all of you. This cup is the New Testament in my blood, which is shed for you for the forgiveness of sins. This do as often as you drink it in remembrance of me." The peace of the Lord be with you always.
Thank you.
May this body and blood evermore strengthen and preserve you unto eternal life. Depart in peace. Amen. Give thanks to you, Almighty God, that you have refreshed us through this salutary gift. And we implore you that of your mercy you would strengthen us through the same in faith toward you and in fervent love toward one another, through Jesus Christ, your Son, our Lord, who lives and reigns with you in the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever.
Amen.
The Lord bless you and keep you. The Lord make his face shine upon you and be gracious unto you. The Lord look upon you with favor and give you peace. Seated. A couple of short announcements. If you're looking at your calendar on inside your bulletin this week, you see that we have left out the Lenten service, the Ash Wednesday service, on Wednesday after the meal at 6 o'clock. The Lent service will begin at 7, and we are not having confirmation. midweek classes on Wednesday. Confirmation, now that we are in the season of Lent, or will be, is on Tuesdays from 6:30 to 8 o'clock. So you're reminded of that. Do you have anything you wanted to announce?
I do.
All right, go for it, buddy.
Don't go nowhere.
I'm not going anywhere. Easier to sit here.
First of all, tomorrow morning, starting at 10 a.m., we're going to start taking down the cross display. So if you're available, it can be here at 10 a.m. We're going to get those taken up because we're going to have some dry spell for a few days. We're a few days behind that. So I want to talk about Pastor Reese. Most of the time when you have a vacancy pastor, they come in from afar. They come here into our Bible study and our service, and then they're gone. Well, luckily, since Pastor Reese is also a member here, he's done some other things for us. He's been in the office 3 days a week helping us out, helping the elders out a lot. He's also helped the elders when we were going through the call process. There at the end, he gave us a lot of guidance. And so on behalf of the elders, pastors, not a lot, but we want to thank you for all the service and what you did for the church during this call process.
Thank you very much. How many of you are coming back this afternoon for the installation? Oh, man, get here a little early. We're figuring around 150 people, so that means we will definitely need the overflow room. The front two pews are going to be reserved for Pastor Edge's family and for the wives of the parade of pastors that will happen. That way they don't have to arm wrestle you for seats. Okay? So, I think that's all you've gotten information. If you haven't picked up a pounding for the edges, do that today. We're not going to stand on any ceremony, right? Okay. Oh, we're German. Was ist Deutsch? Mardi Gras in German, Fasching. So we don't do Mardi Gras, we do Fasching. Go in peace, serve the Lord.